Good morning. Let's stand together, shall we? And Father, we bow before you this morning. And I pray we bow from our hearts to your heart. What a wonderful song we just had played. What does heaven mean to me? To us? Thank you, there's a heaven to gain and there's a hell to shun. Thank you that you would allow your beloved son to die on an old rugged cross for our sins. And that he would pay our sin debt in full by his shed blood, would go to the grave, spend 3 days and three nights in a borrowed tomb, rise again, ascend to heaven, seated this morning at thy right hand, interceding on our behalf, soon coming again. But until that day, help us to be faithful, help us to be looking for him, listening for the trump, and learning more about him and loving one another. Thank you for these who've gathered this morning, those, Lord, who've turned in on the internet. Pray you'd give us a great morning. Pray for that soul that's nearest hell. Pray for that backslidden Christian that has lost the joy, not their salvation, but the joy of it. Oh God, may there be repentance and revival in our service this morning. Bless the special music, the piano playing, the singing, the nursery, junior church, those who are away from us, those who are ill, away from us. Pray for your healing hand, those who are in the auditorium, and Lord, going with issues with these bodies. Thank you for thy healing hand. Thank thee for thy amazing grace. Bless our morning service, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Number 244, as you're standing. 244, hard not to stand for this song. 244. While you're standing, please. James chapter 4 and verse number 6. James chapter 4 and verse 6. We'll say it together four times. James 4 and verse number 6. What a verse. What a verse. My topic this morning is Amazing Grace. I've taken this text this morning because twice in this verse we find the word grace. Grace. Okay, ready? Let's begin. James chapter 4, verse 6. But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. James chapter 4, verse 6. But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. James chapter 4, verse 6. But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. James chapter 4, verse 6. But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. You may be seated. So if you still have your songbook available, 243. So Amazing Grace that brings victory to the twice born child of God. Verse 243. Victory in Jesus. Page 243.
Precious blood atoning, then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Love me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he is built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
thank you, Janet, that this time Stan is going to come up and do a special.
That is greater than all. pointless roads to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, I know how that goes. The battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. Forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. Were it not for grace.
James chapter 4, please. Thank you for that, Stan. James chapter number 4. If I were to ask you this morning, how many of you have bite marks on your body? Have you ever been bitten by another Christian? Paul talks about that in the book of Galatians chapter 5 and verse 15, that we do not bite and devour one another. James is going to talk about wars. Sometimes your home is a battlefield when it should be a place of grace. Sometimes in the church house, God's people get sideways with one another. Get angry, they get offended. And sometimes we, like the world, I'm talking about real Christians, wear our feelings on our sleeves and we get hurt easily because we live too much in our flesh and not enough in the spirit. So James here, by the way, James, the half-brother of our Lord, James the oldest of the four brothers of Mary and Joseph. Oh yes, she had children after the virgin birth of Christ, four sons and possibly three daughters. James the oldest, James the unbeliever. All of Jesus's half-brothers and sisters were unbelievers until after the resurrection. After the resurrection, they realized who their brother was. James wrote the five chapters of the book of James, which is almost like the book of Proverbs because it has little catchy sayings in it. And then Jude, the other brother of our Lord, wrote the tremendous little one-chapter book of Jude. So James here is going to start off with warring in our flesh. Then he's going to talk about how the Holy Spirit wants to control our flesh, if we allow him. And then he's going to talk about the fact that too many of God's children have become enemies of the Lord because of their love for the world and not for Christ. I'd like you to look carefully at your Bible this morning. I hope there's no distractions this morning, disturbances. Babies are always welcome if they start making a little bit of noise. The nursery is always available. But please look carefully here in James chapter 4, verses 1 through 10. From which come wars and fightings, see it, among you? Come they not hence, even of your own lust? That's not just talking about sexual lust, but that is your desires to want to be a winner, that war in your members. You lust and have not, you kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight in war, yet you have not because you ask not. Sometimes people wonder why God doesn't answer their prayers. God always answers your prayers, maybe not just the way you want him to answer them and in the timing that you want him to answer, but God always answers our prayers. You ask, verse 3, and receive not. Why? Because you ask amiss, for evil reasons, that you may consume it upon your own lust. Now, if you're counting, the word lust there is in these three verses several times. The Holy Spirit is saying to us, be mindful of your flesh. Now, here it is. Now, James is going to use spiritual words when he talks about adulterous. That's not physical. This is spiritual. Ye adulterers, men, and adulteresses, know ye not, here it is, that the friendship of the world is enmity with God. Now think about what James is saying here. Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Think about it this morning. Are you an enemy of God? Are you an enemy of God? If the world is your oyster, what does that mean, oyster? What do you get out of an oyster? Sometimes you get a pearl. Is the world your pearl? Is the world running your life? Does the world run your life every day in the world? You have to make choices. You made a choice this morning to come out to the church house. I'm so glad that you came out. You may have been dragged here, screaming and trying not to come, but now you're here. And so for the next several moments, be really good for us to look to the Lord and realize, am I an enemy of God? Have I gone to the world system that crucified my Savior? I'm talking about Christians now. Not a Christian, of course, you can't go against the world because you're in the world. Paul said, we're in it, but not of it. Now here it is. Verse 5. Do you think that the scripture saith in vain? The spirit that dwelleth in us, there's that word again, only a different word, lusteth to envy. That is, the Holy Spirit needs your body. Paul says in Romans 12, in verse 1, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. How do you get your mind renewed? By saturating it in the Word of God. But he giveth more grace. Don't miss that. Please don't miss that. But he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, O my soul. You see, pride is a sin that you cannot see. 1 John chapter 2, turn over there, please. I have you turn the several scriptures this morning so that you can see that I'm preaching the Word of God and not Glennonite theology. Are you a Glennonite? Are you a Glennonite? Are you a Glennonite? Follow the man that follows the Lord. Amen. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Love not the world. See it? James says it. Now here John says it. By the way, John is a cousin of James. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Impossible. It's impossible for you to serve two masters. It's impossible for you to live in two world systems. I'm not talking about the animal kingdom. I'm not talking about nature. I'm not talking about I'm talking about the world system. The world system is anti-God. Government is anti-God. Academia, school is anti-God. The world is anti-God. Churches are anti-God. What? Churches in the last days, the Bible says, will be like the church of the Laodiceans. What is the Laodiceans? Well, that is people run. People run the church and they don't want God in it. And that's why Revelation 3:20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him." We're living in the final days, my beloved. We're living in the days when Jesus could come at any moment. He could come. And the world has become so corrupt, and God's churches have become so corrupt, that all they want is music, and they want the world into the church. They have brought the world into the church, the world's music, the world's dress, and they've dishonored God. And God said that they kicked him out. They kicked him out, and that's why he's knocking at the door. They said they have need of nothing, and God says that you're wretched and miserable and poor and blind. That's what God said in Galatians, or in Revelation chapter 3. Now let's notice. For all that is in the world, notice three things. This is how Eve fell in the garden. This is how you and I fall when we sin. For all that is in the world, first of all, the lust of the flesh. This is young people. Young people. Young people. Young people have their flesh. You shouldn't run around showing your belly button, girls. You should not, especially as a Christian, run around showing your belly buttons, other parts of your body. The flesh. Flee youthful lust, Paul said to young Timothy. Flee it. Run from it. Don't hang around with it. We're living in a pornographic world. The world has gone to hell. You cannot walk around in the store and not see some pornography. It's all around us. The lust of the eyes. Eve saw it. Eve tasted it. And you and I suffer today because of Adam and Eve. Adam should have been in control. He was not. God said, guard the garden. Care for the garden. He did not guard, and Satan got in. Notice number three. And the pride of life. See that? You cannot see pride. You can see a Christian smoking a cigarette. You can see their hands are tarnished from the cigarette. But you can't see pride. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. How did Satan fall? Pride. Pride is a terrible sin that we all encounter. Pride. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Is not of the Father, but is the world. Now watch this now. Verse 15, world, world, world. Verse 16, world, world. Verse 17, and the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God does what? Abides forever. Back to James 4, please. Verse 6, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore he said, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. Verse 7, here's the struggle. Here's the everyday struggle of God's children, and this preacher included. If you think I have arrived, I have not arrived. Every day of my life, I struggle with the world, the flesh, and the devil. And Paul said, know you not that to whom you yield your members, servants to obey, his servants you are, sin unto death or obedience unto right. So every day in the world, every day in the world, I've got to keep this body dead. But it doesn't want to die. It wants to live. Submit yourself therefore to God. Why? Because of fighting and bickering. Because of the world gnawing and pulling. Because of Christians who get their feelings hurt and they want to retaliate and they want to pull down other Christians and take God's people away from the work of the Lord. How sad. How very sad. I cannot tell you. I cannot tell you how my heart is breaking. Breaking. Oh, my soul. Walking into a store this week, seeing a young lady who used to come to this church. A young lady. Now, back into the world. 38 years is a long time to preach in one place. June began 39 years. 38 years done. This shirt, we're done. 38 years I've been here. I can't tell you the ruined lives, the wrecked lives, because someone decided to go out in fellowship with the world. Jacob had 12 sons and one daughter, Dinah. And one day, Dinah, the Bible says, she went into the world. And what? She got raped. One day into the world. Hebrews says that Moses endured afflictions with the people of God. Rather to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. I would lie to you this morning to tell you that sin is not pleasurable. But my heart is broken. I'm thinking of a family used to sit over here. Two young sons, gone. Thinking of a gal who sat right over here. Enjoyed dominoes with us. Praying for her three daughters to come from the Philippines to Canada. And they came, but she had already found a lost man. Lost men are predators. Predators. They come into unexpected churches. And they steal away our young girls and boys. So you must be on the lookout. You must submit yourself to God. That is every day in the world making up your mind. And through the day, you're going to be for God. You're going to be for God. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil. Now, I've heard many preachers preach on this seventh verse, and they forget the first part. Resist the devil and he flee. No, submit yourself to God. You are no match for the devil, and neither am I. That's why Paul said, put on the whole armor of God, that you may withstand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against spiritual wickedness in the high places. Wherefore, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth, the breastplate of righteousness, feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. The shield of faith. The shield of faith. Not a little thing on your arm, but a door. Get behind the door. The helmet of salvation. Because Satan gets in your mind. And when Satan gets in your mind, he's got you. The moment you let Satan get in your mind, he's got you. He's got you because you've walked away from this book. When you walk away from this book, he said to Eve, yea, hath God said. Yea, you cannot believe that book. Yea, hath God said. Four words. Four words. And Eve saw it. She took it. She tasted it. And Adam said, give me the fruit. Adam had never seen Eve like this before. They were naked. Well, how the devil corrupts nudity, doesn't he? They were fearfully and wonderfully made and naked. And there was no guilt because there was no sin. But when sin got in, Satan pitched to Eve, not to Adam. He pitched to the woman, the weaker vessel. He pitched to Eve. Yea, hath God said. And she began to talk with him and reason with him. And she saw the fruit, able to make one wise, beautiful fruit, tasty fruit, and she took it, and you and I and our loved ones have died because of that. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, and so death passes upon all men, for all have sinned. It's appointed unto man once to die. And after this, where are you going when you die? Why do you think I had that song played this morning before I started in prayer? This is what heaven means to me. Heaven is a wonderful place. But beloved, if you're not born again, you're not going. There'd be no Baptists in heaven. Be no religion in heaven. Only those saved by God's amazing grace. Amazing grace, free grace, full grace,
forever grace. Resist the devil, he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, that's what I work. That's how I work. You work and I work. Ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. James says, excuse me, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Double-minded. Going here, I'm going there, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. No. Be steady, Eddie. Be steady. Double-minded is man is unstable in all his way. Be afflicted and mourn, weep, let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. See it? Verse 10. Humble yourself. People say, I'm an humble person. Humble. Humble, 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 humble. I'm a humble person. No, you're not. You tell someone you're humble, you ain't humble. You are not humble if you're walking around like a peacock. You know, men have a problem. They're peacocks. They have a whole bunch of pride. A whole bunch of pride. Men are peacocks. Yeah, I know you're waiting, right? What are women? What are women? If men are peacocks, what are women? Lovey-dovey. What are women? They're followers. They follow. They follow your lead. You ever say to your wife, I love you? What does she say? Yeah, drop dead. No, what does she say? She says, I love you too. You see, love is a verb and it shows action. When you say, I love you, they say, I love you back. Humble yourself in the sight of God that he may lift you up. Notice, that he may lift you up. Look at the next verse. I want to stop there. Speak not evil one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother. You know why you speak evil of others? You know why you put down others? Because you want to build yourself up. Mm-hmm. You know why your ear gets about this big when you hear about some gossip about someone falling? Because you want to be a peacock. Men and women are peacocks. You want to be prideful. And you want everybody to look at you. And not all of us are that way, of course. But we think about this being unkind with one another. Yeah, I've been to that church. People are very friendly, but the pastor. That's all you need to say. People there are very friendly. They're loving, kind people, beautiful church house, but the pastor. But the pastor what? That's all you have to say. I can say, you know, such and such, however. And that's where we begin to tear down people. Speak not evil one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother and judgeth his brother, speaketh evil of the law and judgeth the law. But if thou judgest the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. Because you can't, anybody here obey the law? There is one lawgiver who is able to save and destroy. Who art thou that judgeth another? Go to now, ye that say today or tomorrow we'll go to such a city, continue there a year, buy and sell and get gain. Whereas you know not what should be on the morrow. But what is your life? What is your life? 70? 70 years. So where are you on that scale? What is your life but a vapor that appeared for a little time and vanished away? For that we ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live, do this or that. But now you're rejoicing and you're boasting. But now ye rejoice in your boastings. All such things are evil. Therefore to him that knoweth, now watch it. Therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth not to him, it's what? Back to verse 6, and I'm done with my intro. Verse 6. But he giveth more grace. Wherefore saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Father,
You know how my heart is breaking, oh my soul. Oh my soul, and moreover your heart. All these years you've provided. All these years you've looked after your people. All these years since the crucifixion of your son. Shedding his blood on the cross, going to the tomb, rising 3 days later, ascending to heaven at your right hand, waiting for you to say, go get my children. All these many years you have blessed. You've met our needs. You've watched over us. Oh, how stubborn we are. How very stubborn we are. How rebellious we are. Have mercy. Lord, I pray that those within the sound of my voice this August morning, oh God, stubborn, rebellious, disobedient we are to you. You love us so tenderly. Loving kindness. Where did that word come from? The Bible. Tender-hearted, the Bible. And Lord, how you love us and how we abuse you and use you. Lord, speak to our hearts, preacher and people. I don't preach that doesn't preach to me first. Speak to us about your amazing grace. Oh, amazing grace. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Isn't it amazing? Isn't it amazing? Grace. How do you spell grace? God's riches at Christ's expense. What is grace? Grace is unmerited favor. You don't deserve it, but God gives it. Romans chapter 5, please. Romans chapter 5. This is amazing. Verse 20. Think about grace. Verse 20. Moreover, the law entered, that the offense might abound. What offense? Adam's sin. But where sin abound, what's the next word?
Grace.
Grace did much more abound. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so, see that? Even so might grace reign unto eternal life by Jesus Christ, our Lord. Think about grace now. Grace. My topic is grace. Ephesians 2, grace. Think about this now. Grace. Where sin abound, grace did much more abound. Ephesians 2. Love this book. Love it. Love it. Chapter 2, verse 4, I love it. Verse 13, I love it. Love this book. God's riches at Christ's expense, grace. Ephesians 1, 2, 3. The wealth of a believer. I have a miserable husband, grace. I have a condescending wife, grace. I have an abusive boss, grace. I have disobedient children, grace. I have slacking parents, grace. I have church members that don't tithe, grace. I have church members that don't show up, grace. I have this and that and the other issue, grace. It's all of grace. Grace gets you in first. If you're here this morning, the 224th day of August, or known of August 11th, if you're here and you're not saved,
That means there's no hope in your life for heaven. You have no heaven. There's no hope for heaven in your life if you're not saved. Saved is not baptistic. Saved is not religious. Saved is God's word. Ephesians 2. And you, Dennis Glennon, you who were dead in trespasses and sins. Now, you missed two words, Pastor. Yeah. Hath he quickened. Those are italicized. That means they were put on by the translators, and I'm not reading the text by not reading them. But if I offend you, I'm going to read it. You hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. Semicolon. Where in times past you walked according to the course of this world. Now watch it. The course of this world. Love not the world. If you love the world, you're an enemy of God, James said. John said, love not the world, neither the things in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life is not of the Father, but of the world. And the world passeth away in the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Or in times past, that was before you got saved, you walked according to the course of this world, according to the, see it, see him, prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. You have disobedient children? You have disobedient children? You need to spank their butts. Oh. Train up a child in the way he should go. When he was old, he not depart from it. The rod of reproof, give correction. Oh, just let him go. Anarchy. Anarchy. Not going to spank my little baby's butt. What do you think the butt's there for? The rod and reproof give correction. While they're babies, you show them, boop, oh, 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 oh. That gets your attention. Go to your room. Okay, I'm going to room, play Nintendo, blah, 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 blah. My iPad. Okay, can I go to my room? Okay, go to your room. No, spank their butts for sin only. Disobedience is sin. Beloved, if they're disobedient to you, they're going to be disobedient to God. Spanking them, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child. But the rod of correction, not your hands. Get your little rod and spank your little butts. Tell them what they've done wrong. Oh, we're going to turn you in. Help yourself. Turn me in. This is over the internet. And I'm not going to jail. I'll send Terry. They'll come and say, where's the pastor of the church? Terry Peisinger is right there. Disobedience is a terrible thing. To obey is better than the sacrifice. For rebellion, this is a sin of witchcraft. Little rebellious, little two-year-old assassin of parents. Take them out and now, don't ever do it in anger. You see, your child needs to know that you're spanking them to keep them out of hell. Keep them out of hell. Why? Judgment day is coming. Why do you think the lawlessness is in the world? All the lawlessness in the world. Because children just help yourself. No, we don't spank our children. No, we don't. Oh, no. But we just send them to the room. Help yourself. The rod and reproof give correction, but a child left to himself bringeth his mother shame. Oh, well, he's too tired. No. You're not doing your job as a parent. You are sorry you came here this morning, aren't you? You are sorry you showed up this morning. Are you okay?
Amen.
All right. All right, verse 3. Among whom also we all had our conversation in times past. That conversation means your conduct. In times past, lust of the flesh, fulfilling desire of the flesh, now watch it, and the mind. And were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. You see that? But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together. You see why the word quickened there in verse number 5 is not necessary in verse number 1? Because verse 5 explains it. Even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. See it? Parenthesis. What are the parentheses? By grace are you saved. By grace are you saved. The only way you're going to heaven is by grace. Grace alone. God's riches at Christ's expense. Unmerited favor. God said, we saw last week in our memory verse in Exodus 3:17, God gave Moses grace. I found grace in thy sight. Thou hast known me by thy name. I found grace in your sight. And God has known me. Knows my name. If it wasn't for grace. If it wasn't for grace, where would I be? I'd be on my way to hell. And hath raised up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come, you see that word ages there? You can't count. Beloved, if heaven is eternal, hell is also eternal. Hell is forever. You come back tonight, I'm preaching on the devil. And the devil that deceived them, Revelation 20:10, was cast in the lake of fire and brimstone with the beast and the false prophet, and should be tormented day and night forever and ever. Hell is not for you. Hell is for the devil and the little devils. That's what God made hell for, the devil. The devil disobeyed God. The devil rebelled against God. The devil took a third of the angels of heaven, and some of those angels are still in Tyre. They're in the pit. They're in the fire. 2 Peter tells us in the book of Jude. Then the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of what? Help me now. His grace and his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. Verse 8. For by what? Grace. Grace is saved through faith, that not of yourself, that's what? Not of works, lest any man should boast. Thank God for his grace. Oh, thank God for his amazing grace. The riches of his grace, saving grace. Look at verse 12. How does this come about? How does this come about? Verse 11, Ephesians 2:11. Wherefore remember that ye being in times past Gentiles in your flesh. Any Gentiles here this morning? If you're a Gentile, raise your hand. Are you Gentile? Any Gentiles here? Well, what are you? Are you Jews? Any Gentiles here? Raise your hand. Are you a Gentile? I'm a Gentile. Some of you must be Jews. You're not raising your hand. Or you're rebellious. Don't want to follow the pastor. Obey them that have the rule over you, for they watch for your souls, that they may give an account. That it may be profitable in you. That's what Paul says in the book of Hebrews. Wherefore, remember that ye being in times past Gentiles in the flesh, who is called uncircumcision by that which is called certain, that's Jew and Gentile, and the flesh made by hands. That at that time, now watch this, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenant of promises, having what? No hope. No hope. Oh my goodness, no hope. Titus, I'd forgotten this verse. Now the Lord just brought it back to mind. Titus chapter 2. We had a teen activity years ago, probably about 40 years ago. Had a teen activity. And there was this girl, this teenager, that came out. She was a guest that night. And I think she was on drugs because she kept saying, no hope! No hope! I thought, this girl was, whoa. Where did she come from? No hope! But look at this. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Where would we be without a Bible? What would I be doing up here? Telling stories, cracking jokes? Thank God we have a Bible. Amen? Amen. Titus 2, verse 11. For the grace of God, the what? Huh? I can't hear you. The what? The what? Grace. Can you say grace? Grace. For the grace of God that bringeth what? Salvation. Hath appeared to all men. What is it going to do for us? Verse 12. Teaching us that denying ungodliness, what kind of lust? Worldly lust. We should live soberly, righteously and godly in this present world. How are you going to do that? How are you going to do that? Next verse. Looking for that blessed hope. Wow. Blessed hope. And for the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. If your husband gave himself for you, if your mother was willing to die for you, would you not love your mama? Would you not love your husband? Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and the Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort, let no man despise thee. Now going back to Ephesians 2, just look at this. This is so marvelous. Verse 12, that at that time you were without Christ, think about it, no Christ, no Christ, you have no Christ, there's no heaven for you. If you don't have Christ, so seriously, what are you bringing in your hands to heaven? What are you bringing in your hands to heaven? Anything? What are you bringing in your pocket? Anything? Are you going to pay your way into heaven? No, it's by grace, through faith, not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So think about that. God has given to us salvation, if we receive it. You ever give something to someone, they say, no, I don't want it? You ever do that? Here, I want to give. No, 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 I don't want it. I'm okay. No, I'd like to give this. No, no, I don't want it. That's the way some people are about salvation. No, I don't want it. I don't want it. I want to do it my way. Isn't that what the little children say? I can do it myself. I want to do it myself. Yeah, help yourself with that. You know, God says, when God's people don't want God, now think about the love of God. When God's people don't want God and they serve idols, that is something made out of metal, clay, or wood that's dead. You have to move it around. It can't move by itself. But when you serve idols and serve the world and you come to God and say, God, I need this, you know what God's going to say to you? Go check out your idol. Go to the world. You're living in the world. You don't want me. Help yourself. And yet God's a loving God. But if we don't want his gift, if we don't want his love, then he says, help yourself. You're on your own. Verse 12, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of God. The promises are not ours. Having no hope without Christ in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, this is so precious. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. Notice, he is our peace, who hath made both one, hath broken down the middle wall partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, sin, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself one, notice, make in himself between one new man, so making peace. They might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached to you peace to you which were far off, and that were not, as Jew and Gentile. That through him we both, notice, we both have access by the Spirit unto the Father. That's saving grace, beloved. Do you have it? Do you have saving grace? 1 Corinthians 15. What's my topic this morning? Grace. Isn't it wonderful? Now, how'd you like to come up here and sing a special all by yourself? How'd you like to go off this afternoon after service and when you go to the restaurant, say to the person as you're paying, can I give you this? This will encourage you about heaven. How many of you want to do that? How many of you would do that? Can I give this to you? This will encourage you about heaven. How about your friend? How about your spouse? How about your family member? Would you take time to tell them about the Lord?
I'm too afraid. I don't think I can do it. That's where grace comes in. 1 Corinthians 15, grace. Saving grace, serving grace. Serving grace. 1 Corinthians 15, notice how many times the word grace is found here. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 10. But by the what?
Grace.
I am what I am. And his what?
Grace.
Which was bestowed upon me was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but
grace.
Which was in me. We labor by his grace. Go back to Ephesians 3. So isn't it wonderful to know, my beloved, that you can serve the Lord by grace. By grace. Whatever the Lord wants you to do, you can labor in this life by grace. He saves you by grace, then you serve by grace. Well, I can't do that position. Yes, you can. If God wants you to do it, that's why I never point out positions. I never tell people, I want you to do this, do that, do that. Would you like to do that? Would you like to pray about that? Would you like to be able to do that? So I don't, you know, there's always jobs to do, but I don't push people. I don't prod people. Give you the opportunity. Look at Ephesians chapter 3. Paul, how about your ministry, Paul? Wherefore I was made a minister according to the what? According to what? You see it? Ephesians 3:7. Are you looking at your Bible? I'm going to do a test later. 3:7. Wherefore I was made a minister according to the gift of the given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, Dennis, you put your name there, who are less than the least of the saints, is this what?
Grace.
Given that I may preach among the Gentiles. Well, I can't preach, I'm a lady. You can witness. You can tell people about Jesus. You can be a witness. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. The unsearchable riches of Christ. Now look at chapter 4. You know, I have a vocation. I have a vocation. Right here in Ephesians 4. Did you know what my vocation is? Look at it. Ephesians 4, verse 11. And he gave some apostles. Am I an apostle? Am I an apostle? No. Why? Apostle had to be one that saw the Lord. Am I an apostle? No. And some prophets. Am I a prophet? No, I'm a proclaimer, but I'm not a prophet. A prophet were those men of old that predicted future events that came to pass. But now we have the whole canon of Scripture. We don't need prophecy. We don't need any new revelation. We need just to believe the old one. And some evangelists. Am I an evangelist? Yes, I am. I am an evangelist. I am an evangelist. I started out as I said to the Lord, Lord, don't ever call me to be a missionary. I'm not going anywhere. I'm an evangelist. Don't call me to be an evangelist or missionary. I'm not going to some strange country. Canada. Canada. I'm not going. Don't even knock on my door because I don't want to hear it. I'm not going. Evangelist. I'm an evangelist. You know what an evangelist is? A church planter. You know who planted this church? You know who planted this church? Moi. That's French. Moi? Is that French? Moi? I know French. Moi. Him. Moi. Vous connaissez ma femme? That's my femme. 1978. How many years have that been? 1978, God put in my little heart Fort McMurray, Alberta, Canada. Did you know that? Where were you in 1978? You're playing with little toys. 1978. How many of you were born in 78, before 78? Anybody? Raise your hand. 78. Well, here are four people, okay. Born before 78. Hold them up there. Raise your hand. You must be older than 78. Come on, raise your hand. Okay, that's now we know how old you are. Notice, and some pastors. Am I a pastor? No, I'm not a pastor.
I've been stuck here for 38 years. I'm an evangelist, pastor and teacher. Am I a teacher? Am I a preacher? Am I a pastor? Yes. Yes. Do I want to be a pastor? Yes, by his grace. So am I an evangelist? What does evangelists do? Tell people to get saved and then plant churches. Do pastors evangelize too? Do they win souls? If they don't, get rid of them. Somebody ever comes behind this pulpit and is not a soul winner, he should never come behind this pulpit. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, what did he give me this job to do? Verse 12. Are you okay now? I'm going to let you out here soon. But are you okay? Like, some of you haven't been here in a while, so I'm getting my... You haven't been here, so I am. We're playing catch up this morning. Amen? Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. So listen, if everybody came to all the services, I'd preach 15-minute sermons. I'm not lying. If everybody came to all the 15 minutes, I'd be done. All this other stuff is for you folks that don't come. Very serious. 15 minutes, I'm done. Listen, if they haven't drilled your tooth after 15 minutes, get another dentist. If a preacher can't drill after 15 minutes, get another preacher. So the added moments are because of thou. Are you okay with me? For the perfecting of the saints, that word perfecting means equipping. For the work of the ministry, for the edifying the body of Christ, till we all, how many? All, that means all of us, till we all come in the unity, what? Of the faith. And the knowledge of the Son of God unto a what? That's in the Bible. Look at mirror.
Perfect.
What? Does it say perfect woman? What does it say? Perfect. Perfect what? And that includes ladies, of course. Under the measure of the stature of the fullness of grace, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, sleight of men, cunning craftiness, whereby they lay in deceit, but speaking the truth and love may grow up in him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together, I'm finishing now, and compacted by that which every joint supplied. How many joints?
Every
joint. You know, I need my thumb. I need my elbow. I need my shoulder. I need my big toe. If I didn't have my big toe, it'd be hard for me to balance myself. So every part supplieth according to the effectual working of the measure of every part. Did this say every part again? It did. Making increase of the body on the edifying of itself in what? Let's stand together. Did somebody just say, shh, that was a long time? Did you just say that? Did you just say, shh? Let's bow. Oh, my soul. It's all of grace. Unmerited favor. God riches at Christ's expense. Oh, God, how wonderful. Salvation is free. It's by faith and it's forever. By grace you save through faith. That not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works. Lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works that God did foreordain that we should walk in them. Oh God. Oh God. Preacher and people, we're one. Pastor and people, we're one. We're all in this thing together. Oh God, help us this morning to see your amazing grace. I pray for that one here, lost, no hope for heaven, stubborn with their religion, full of pride. Lord, there is no religion, there is no name on any church that can get anybody to heaven. That's a lie straight out of hell. No denomination, no churchianity. It's Christ or hell. Lord, save that soul that's near as hell this morning. How you long to be their Savior. How you've made
the way for them to get to heaven by your precious Son, shedding his blood, going to the grave, rising victoriously, seated at your right hand this morning, waiting for one lost sinner to repent and say, I receive you, Lord Jesus. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Save my soul. And they'll be saved. And you'll be happy. And the Bible says that the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner that repents. Lord, maybe there's some loved one in heaven this morning of someone in this church or someone listening over the internet. And they're praying, oh God, save my husband, save my wife, or save my children that I've left behind. Save my grandfather, save my father, save that brother, save that sister, save that friend, save that relative. Oh God, angels in heaven rejoice in the presence. That is, they rejoice because there's folks in heaven saying glory to God. Glory to God. This Sunday morning, they recorded my husband's name in the book. They recorded my son's name in the book. Glory to God. Oh God. Oh, for your amazing grace. Unmerited favor. We don't deserve it. We don't earn it. Paid in full. Thank the Lord. Father, I pray now that you will get our attention. No preacher is an island. No Christian is an island. We need one another. Oh, how we need one another. Do our part. Lift that pail. Lift that barge. Pull up the sinner. Push up the saint. Reclaim the backslider. Oh, my soul. Lord, I'm just nothing. How it must totally break your heart to see your children go astray, to see them walk out on you, turn their back on you, backslidden, stepping with the world again, going back to their own haunt, going back to their old habits, going back to their own lifestyle. Oh, my soul, how that breaks your heart. And the Spirit of God that dwells in us that are saved, he gets quenched, he gets grieved, and he gets vexed. Oh God, help us this morning to do right. In a moment, we'll give an altar call. May souls come to be saved. Oh God, may a wife, a husband, a child, a brother, a sister, maybe tap their loved one on the shoulder in a moment. Say, won't you come and receive Jesus as your Savior? I'll go with you. Won't you come this morning and get saved? Oh God, eternity is forever. Forever in heaven or forever in hell. God, save the soul that's nearest hell. Listening in over the internet, oh God, that someone this morning would say yes to Jesus. Repent, turn from their religion. The religion will never get them in heaven. Turn from their baby baptism. Turn from their religion and trust your Son as Savior. Open their heart, repent of their sin, receive Jesus as their Savior. Oh, may that happen this morning. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Preacher, pray for me this morning. I'm saved. Heaven's my home, and I'm looking forward to heaven. I'm rejoicing that I'm going to heaven. My name's in God's book. Here's my hand as a testimony. Could you do that this morning? Could you do that? Just raise it up there. I'm saved. Heaven's my home. I know that for sure. I know that for sure. Would you just hold it up there? Maybe just wave at Jesus. Love you, Jesus. You may take them down. Now, would you be honest this morning with yourself? Not with me. I don't count. But with God. Would you be honest to say, I'm not saved. I'm lost. God knows I'm lost. Oh, don't be ashamed of Jesus. The scripture saith, whosoever believeth him should not be ashamed. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. And by the way, 1 John says that he will be ashamed of you at his coming. When he comes, he'll be ashamed. You're mine, but you didn't love me enough to stand for me. You didn't love me enough to get out of the world. You didn't love me enough to tell others about me. Oh God, reckoning day is coming. The judgment seat of Christ is coming. I'm not saved, preacher. I need to be saved. Would you remember me? Here's my hand. Please remember me in closing prayer. I'm not saved. I need to be saved. I'm a Christian. I'm saved. I know I'm saved. Saved by grace. I haven't been baptized in deep water since I've been saved, but I am saved. But I'm not living the Christian life fully. Folks, it doesn't work. What I mean by it doesn't work is if you're not all in, then you're not all in. Whatsoever thy hand find to do with all thy might. If you're not all in, beloved, you're not all in. And your life is living mediocrity. Mediocrity. No joy in your soul. You know that your life is not right with the Lord. Oh, this morning. Preacher, pray for me. There's some matters in my life that God is dealing with. As a Christian, would you pray for me? Here's my hand. Preacher, pray for me this morning in my areas of my life not right with God. I know it. He knows it. Would you pray for me? Here's my hand. Would you be honest? Pray for me. Pray for me. And Father, how we love you. Thank you that you do see in our hearts. Thank you that you're long-suffering. Oh, God. If I would have my way in people's lives, it never worked. And that's why a wise old man told me years ago, let the Holy Spirit be the disciplinary committee. Spirit of God, I pray that you'll do what you wonderfully do. Convict sinner of sin. Convict that backslidden Christian that they need to come to get right. Oh God, convict that mediocre Christian that's sitting around waiting. I don't know what they're waiting for. But oh, may they decide, I'm going to get in. Some have asked, preacher, is anything to be done? You need any help somewhere? Lord, what a blessed sound that is. But even moreover, be able to say to our Heavenly Father, Father, I'm available. Use me, send me, use me, mold me, make me, break me. I'm available. Oh, that might happen this morning. Bless now this invitation in Jesus' name. Amen. Singing number 277, we're going to sing a cappella this morning. And so if you need to come, would you come on the first stanza?
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you.
You need to come, would you come on this stanza?
For Jesus shed his precious blood, rich blessings to restore. Plunge now into that crimson flood that washes white as snow. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now.
He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now.
Yes, Jesus is the truth, the way that leads you into rest. Believe in him without delay, and you are truly blessed. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you.
Here's the invitation.
Come then and join this holy band, and unto glory go, to dwell in that celestial land, where joy immortal flows. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now.
And you may be seated. Let's have the men come. And Carl, can you turn me up a little bit, please? Let's have the men come this morning. We'll receive our morning offering. And as they're coming to you, and if you're not a member of this church, you're not responsible to give. But if you are a member, if you are a member, would you do your due diligence? Would you be faithful in your giving?
obey the Lord and give. We don't give to get saved, but we give because we are saved. We don't work to get saved, but we work because we are saved. Now, concerning the collection of the saints, I mean, just think of it. I don't know how you can sit there, really, and I'm not being unkind. I don't know how you can sit there as a member of Emmanuel Baptist Church and not support this church. I really don't know how you can do it. Now, concerning the collection for the saints, as I've given order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye. Upon the first day of the week, that's Sunday, let every one of you, not some, not a few, lay by him in store as God hath prospered him, that there be no gathering when I come. And when I come, whomsoever you shall approve by your letters, them will I send to bring your liberality unto Jerusalem. So first day of the week is Sunday. Sunday's the Lord's day. And you're responsible as a child of God. As a child of God. As a child of God. I don't know how you could be a child of God and not give back to him. Tithe belongs to him. Doesn't belong to me. We give tithes and offerings. So I don't know how you can be a child of God. I don't know how you can sit Sunday after Sunday, week after week, and I'm happy you have a nice automobile. I'm happy you have a nice home, a nice clothes, food on the table. But if you're a God robber, that's a terrible deal. A God robber, to rob God of what belongs to him. He loves you, and oh, that you would do right. Gusta, would you pray for this offering, please?
Heavenly Father, thank you again for thy word. Pray that may you inculcate it in our mind, that we live with the practice in our daily life. And Lord, thank you again for meeting all our needs and patience that we are able again to give this tithing offering. We pray that may you bless it for the furtherance of your word. We ask this in Christ's precious name.
Amen. Amen. Play like the piano's playing.